Hey founders, this is the SaaS Boss Show, the podcast for SaaS founders in the growth stage who want to get unstuck, build high-performing teams, and get clarity about how to build a profitable startup. Every week, I interview SaaS consultants, coaches, and experts who work with dozens of startups just like yours and share their best strategies to overcome the daily challenges of growing a profitable SaaS. My name is Natalie Luniva, and I'm a growth and leadership coach to SaaS founders. And I'm also married to a SaaS founder. And I'm so pleased that you've joined us on this conversation. Hi, everyone. In this episode of SaaS Boss Show, I interviewed James Rose, a Zapier and automation trainer, and a SaaS founder as well. And today we talk about new and awesome ways to get more done in the same time and automate the parts of your business that you can do less of. Welcome to the show, James.
Awesome to be here, Natalie. Thank you so much for having me.
So how did you start with the automations? Such an interesting area.
Yeah, it's gone back quite a while, actually. I used to be an automation engineer, or like control systems engineer, which in like English means I basically wrote code that controlled machinery, like in the field. So like coal mining or pumping stations or all kinds of strange machinery. But it was super fun. I love the work, but I just got sick of working with people that I didn't really like. So that's how I ended up in business, right? I left that, but I really missed the work. Like automation was just so much fun to me. So I guess when I discovered like Zapier and the ability to automate things online, you know, like home automation, all that sort of stuff, it became like a little bit of a fix for me to get that, you know, automation fun that I used to have, but in a business world. So that's kind of how it started. Because of that, I've automated so much in my business over several years. And at this point, lots of people have asked me for help with it. So I've created a course around Zapier and I've started like a productivity and automation blog, which is a total side business that came about by accident because people just wanted help with it.
Awesome. I'm huge on increasing productivity. I think everyone is. It's just sometimes we maybe not really know what, you know, how to go about it. Everyone want to buy back more of their time, right? And do more with less. It's just sometimes maybe we just need a little bit more information or like some tips and ideas. So I love the idea of having you here and sharing some stories and ideas that can help us automate and increase our productivities. So tell us about some of your top productivity tricks as far as automation goes.
Awesome. Yeah, you're right. Like getting started is the hardest part. Like it is by far the biggest roadblock to everyone I speak to. They're like, all this automation stuff sounds good, but like, where do I even start? Every business is so different that it's kind of hard to just say, here's a thing that'll work for everybody. At least, you know, if I'm talking, I know I'm talking to SaaS companies, then there are a few like cool ideas we can talk about. And there's kind of a couple of categories here, right? Like there's Zapier, which is where a lot of my automation work happens, which is like, if for those aren't familiar, it's kind of a tool that connects different apps together. So, you know, if someone fills out a contact form, you can add them to your CRM. That's like the classic example, but you can get a lot more complicated than that and actually create like workflows where it's like, it, you know, when someone submits the contact form, you might look that person up in a different system. And if they match these criteria, then send them over to this spreadsheet or send yourself a message to follow up with them, you know, like, so you can create kind of complex workflows. The other side of thing is just like general productivity. So I don't know, where would you like to start there?
Let's start with ways we can automate things in our businesses and SaaS companies. So let's talk about lead generation maybe, or improving our pipeline.
Yeah, cool. Well, that's actually one of my favorite automations that I like to talk to SaaS companies about, because like some other people don't really understand how powerful this one is. Okay, so here's my favorite Zap in my SaaS business. And it is when someone signs up for our trial, Zapier catches that email address and sends it to a little app, which is built into Zapier called Lead Score by Zapier. And I think it's kind of named incorrectly. It's not really lead scoring. It's more lead enrichment. If you're not familiar with lead enrichment, it basically means from an email address, you can get a lot of other information about somebody just from an email address. You can get like the company they work for, their personal Twitter profile, their company Twitter profile, like how many people work for that company, what state they work in, the number of staff, right? And for a lot of SaaS companies, the number of staff is a pretty good indicator of how good of a client that person is, especially if you've got per user pricing or something like that. You know, we have tiered systems for Content Snare, which is our software product. You know, we've got tiered plans where more staff means they're on a higher plan. So depending on how many staff they have, I can then filter different workflows to say, you know, if it's like less than 5, nothing happens. If it's between like 10 and 100, it puts them into what's called a digest in Zapier. There's a block in Zapier called a digest, which just rolls up lots of items. And then at the end of the day, it releases all those items together. So a digest is basically just building a block of text, you know, like a long string of lots of items together. So for me, what I do is into the digest, I put in like the company name, where they're from, and how many staff they have into one piece of the digest. So all it's doing is rolling up all those people that were between 10 and 100 staff all day. And at the end of the day or in the next morning, like when I wake up, it drops the digest into my Trello, which is my personal to-do system. So whatever, you know, task management you use, you can just drop it in there. And now I have this list of like, it could be 10, could be 20, of however many companies have signed up between 10 and 100 staff, and I can quickly scan through and see if there's any that I want to reach out to. I just click the email address and write them an email. Most of the emails already written, which we can talk about later in like text expansion is another productivity tool that I love. But then I can say if it's more than 100 staff, it sends me an email right away or puts that into my to-do list right away. It could send me an SMS, you know, whatever notification system you want to use. So if there's like an ideal client that signs up for your tool, you can immediately get a notification that they just signed up. And why this is so freaking awesome is because you can get on. They're probably still demoing, you know, they're playing around in there. And if you reach out to them, especially if you've got like a live chat or something, they're there and you can start chatting to them right away. And that's happened to me with a really, really big client. Like our biggest client is, it's an airline that like pretty much everyone listening to this would have heard of. And we got on a call like right away because I reached out to them. They were online. We started chatting and got on a call with like a bunch of their team, and now they're a client. So yeah, just like in short, so that's why it's my favorite app. It's so simple. It's like someone signs up, look them up in a lead score, in Lead Score by Zapier, and based on how many staff they have, either send me a notification right away or put them in a digest. Like that's all it is. And that is super powerful.
That's awesome. That's the first one. Give us a few more.
Another one that I really like, and I've actually been combining it with that one we just spoke about, is using a tool called Bonjoro. And that's a video platform, I guess you'd say, personal video platform. So what Zapier can then do is you just need a trigger. If someone shows up, if someone signs up, put them into Bonjoro. And it's a phone app and a web app where it just shows you the list of people that you've like decided to record a video for, and you click on them and you record a quick video and it sends to them basically. And the sounds super basic, but let's just say companies aren't used to getting a personal video when they sign up for a tool, or like maybe when they sign up for a paid plan. So basically, like this is something you could do pretty easily, right? With any old video recording tool. You could say, okay, our big company signed up. They're in the trial phase. I'm going to use Loom or some other video tool to send them a video and say, hey, I'm Bob from X company. I saw you signed up. Just wondering how it's been going so far. If you have any questions, reach out to me. Like actually comment on their website, you know, like, so they know it's a personal video, comment on their company. And they pretty much everyone responds to that because they're like, they don't expect that you've like the founder or maybe a marketing person, whatever, anyone in the company has actually done a personal video. So that's what I've been doing for companies of a certain size as well. Like literally just sitting here either in my office or, you know, at home, wherever, I'll do a recording. But what makes Bonjoro different than other video tools is that all the process around it is automated, right? So the email has been captured. It filtered out like how many staff they had or whatever. And then it just drops in like a to-do item in my Bonjoro app. All I've got to do is click that. Look at the data that's come in. So where their website is, maybe have a quick look at their website on my phone, do whatever. All I do is click the icon, record video for like 30 seconds and hit send and it's done. And then it'll, you know, put it in a nice email, send it to them. If they don't open it, it'll follow up in 3 days. So this is what I call like automation assisted personalization, which is so you can get really personal with, I guess, a big pushback on automation is that it's not personal. And this is like the perfect example where you've only taken 30 seconds of your time to give someone a really good personal experience when they sign up for whatever it is that you have. And it can make such a big difference when they get that personal video.
So let's take a step back and take a look from like a macro perspective on this. I know you guys, software engineers, you were like so into all of those tools and, you know, all of those technical things that maybe sometimes you may even miss the whole point. So let's talk about some areas of our business that can be automated or should be automated, or things that you see majority of founders do not do. So let's first talk about like the biggest areas of opportunity.
So there are a few categories here. And the first one is, I mean, pretty easy. It's basically double handling. So if you are having to move like the same piece of data between multiple systems. So like the classic example is like some people might be using a contact form that emails them and then you have to copy the email address and put it in a CRM. Like I imagine most SaaS founders have already automated that kind of thing. I hope so. You know, everyone's at different stages, I guess, but that's just a classic example, right? But you know, for example, like digital agency life, which I come from, you might want that client. Like if someone signs up or signs a proposal or something, you might want to create a project for them in the project management system. You might want to put move their deal stage in your CRM, like put them into your accounting system. Like that's the same piece of data that you're moving, like that company details is going into multiple systems. So that's the perfect opportunity for automation. Anything where you're handling the same piece of data multiple times, or if you have to like log into a system to find out what that data was, you know, like I was talking before about how it just drops all the best leads of the day into my task management system. I guess the alternative there is logging into your CRM and scrolling through and seeing who's signed up. You know, like that to me is just a shit process. I don't want to do that. So I'd rather have it in front of me. I don't have to log into another system and do it. So that's like the first category, double handling. And the next most obvious one is repetitive. So if you're doing the same thing over and over again, like whatever that happens to be. So some examples of that might be like, creating a folder structure. If you're a digital agency, you've got to create a folder structure for each new client or something, or check-ins with your clients. You know, like we like to check in with customers of our SaaS product, and I don't want to have to go and sort of manually email them all the time. So you set up regular check-ins or whatever and see how they're going.
That's cool. What tools do you use for that? I think that's really interesting.
Yeah. So, I mean, pretty much any marketing automation tool you can use for that. That's not a Zapier thing. You know, you can do that with Intercom. You can do it with ActiveCampaign. We use ActiveCampaign for most of our email, but Intercom for support, just because ActiveCampaign's automation capabilities are like 100-fold what Intercom have. Intercom's kind of basic.
You know what? I love the idea of checking in with the customers, be it marketing agency or SaaS. It's really, we don't do that often enough, right? So how do you have it set up for your SaaS? How often do you send it? Do you send the same message? Is it every month?
So it has changed a little bit. We used to have a message. It used to be the same message every month, but you know, that gets... people get blind to that pretty quick. So then it chooses a different email each time. But now we're actually pretty selective. Now that the business has grown, we don't want to send, you know, thousands that email all the time. So I have like a filter in Intercom that like selects people based on the last time I sent them a message. So if they get sent a message, they drop off the list. And like how much they've been using the app, for example. So you can segment them into like, I don't know, people that haven't used the app in a month or something, or people that are very active. So you might choose to send the people that have logged in 20 times in the last month a different message you know, to say, hey, it looks like you guys are getting good use out of this. Just want to make sure, you know, just, I don't know, maybe you might ask for a testimonial. You might ask for, just ask how things are going and thank them for being an active user. But then if someone is in that, like, slipping away category, they call it, where they haven't logged in a while, you might send a different message, see like what's going on, try and get on top of it before they cancel. Sometimes I select, like I've got the filter where I can see all the people in a certain category, and I might just select, you know, 30 of them to send that message to, but it's still somewhat automated, right? And that's what a lot of this is. It's kind of like semi-automated stuff. I automate like 100% automate a lot of crap as well, but some of these things are better as like semi-automated, I feel.
And it's much better than not automated, because sometimes when you start approaching a task and you're like, oh my goodness, that's going to take me, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes. I'll do it later. While if you have it semi-automated, it's much easier for you to approach the task. It doesn't look as big to you.
Yeah, it's easy to start just like ignoring stuff, you know, like for that example where I get the best leads coming each day. Like if I'm too busy, I'm not going to go and log into the CRM and scroll through. But if it's dropped into my to-do list and it's right there in front of me, like it's pretty easy to just click on it, scroll through, maybe send an email or two if they fit the criteria. Like, yeah, it just makes everything so much easier. And I guess I'm like a completionist as well. Like if I see it on my task management, it's got to get done. So
you're an exception.
Right. I can't just delete it off there. Everything, I try to get everything back to zero, you know, like zero inbox, zero tasks, zero inbox in intercom as well. I just can't deal with outstanding items.
So we talked about double handling. We talked about repetitive things. Any other categories?
Yeah. So I was kind of getting into it there a little bit, actually, like stuff you forget or don't want to do. So like exactly that, where I'm like logging into another system each day to check who's signed up. Like that's something I'll forget if it doesn't drop right in front of me in my to-do list. So that's a good example. Project management activity. Like if you want to be on top of all the development that's going on in your SaaS business. So I have a Zap that uses Digest again. So every time a task gets moved into the done column, which means it's been pushed out to production, so that's in Jira, it puts that in a Digest for me and drops it in at the end of the week, or I think it's Monday morning or something. And then I have a list of all the new features and items that have been rolled into the latest production build. And then I can create a video. You know, I might do a text post, depending on how big, you know, the features are that we've released. I'll either do a text update or a video update and tell people what's new just by looking through that list and sort of making sure I've covered off each one. So that is super handy. And another thing I typically forget are social media mentions. So, you know, I don't remember to jump online and search for our brand or whatever. So there's lots of different alert tools you can use for social media mentions. You can also use Zapier. You know, you can have a search-based trigger for Twitter and have it just, again, drop into your task management or whatever. You know, something that's in your face. However you get through your tasks, you can. That's where the task needs to be added, right? Like that's why I'm a big fan of having sort of one system. So I use Trello for my personal stuff. Everything comes into there, everything that I need to get done. And because I stay there all day. So if there's something I'm going to forget, something I know I need to do, I use Zapier to get it in there. So it gets done. And the final category is excessive email. So this isn't, it's not as prominent, I guess, as like digital agency life or like professional services. But just in case you have some people listening there, like anything that requires several back and forward emails to have an outcome, right? And I mean, the classic example, which probably applies to SaaS founders if you're doing demos, is like trying to find a time for a demo. I mean, by now, most people are using calendar booking links, but some people aren't. And it's pain in the ass. Like if I get someone that's like, what time do you want to meet? And then it's like, oh, this time. And it's like, oh, wait, the time zone's wrong. It's daylight savings. I can't do that time. You know, and then you end up with this email storm. It's just so, so annoying. Just use a booking link. If you don't have a system already, Calendly is amazing. And I mean, this is kind of a self plug, but like Content Snare, this is exactly what we were trying to solve with. The professional services have to get a lot of content and information from clients. or documents, you know, like mortgage brokers, finance professionals have to get documents. And it ends up being these email threads that are like, oh, you didn't send me the fourth document from the list that I asked for. And actually that thing you wrote, like if it's a website, it's like, oh, but your headline's no good. You need to rewrite that. And you end up with this like 97 long email trail. And it just, that's what we've tried to solve with our product for getting content from clients.
My husband also shared with me that we're using HubSpot as CRM for his SaaS. So instead of buying the $600 a month package, he is using an automation to move a prospect into a different stage using the automation as well. What CRM are you using?
I use ActiveCampaign and Intercom together.
Any other additional automations that you have not mentioned just yet that you think would be?
One random one, actually, that I kind of borrowed from HubSpot. Is one, it goes out like 2 or 3 days before their trial ends. It just sends an email that says, how likely are you to continue using Content Snare? And there's three buttons, likely, unsure, or unlikely. And based on which one they click, it puts them all into, again, a digest in my to-do, in my Trello, my task management system. So I can see that this person clicked likely, this person clicked unsure, this person clicked unlikely, and I can quickly compose an email to any of them if I feel it's necessary, because you can also include some other data about their account in the digest. So that's like a kind of cool idea. Asking for reviews and testimonials, very SaaS specific. So if you've got a value metric that's like, you know, really depends. For us, it's like the value, people realize the value from our product when they've sent an information request to their client and their client starts giving them information. So after there's maybe like 20 items that they've given back, they're actually starting to see value in the product. So that's when we pop up a message or an email and say, oh, that, you know, awesome to see that your clients are giving you information. How's it going? Basically ask them for like, if they'd like to leave a review or a testimonial. Same thing with like NPS scores. A lot of SaaS people use NPS. So, you know, you can send out emails based on what score they replied with. You know, we've actually pulled the automation from that now. We're doing it. We've actually hired a new sort of customer success / product manager who's going to send manual emails to these people based on what score they give us. But before, you know, if they gave us a high score, we'd ask them to do a video testimonial in exchange for some account credit. So yeah, that's kind of another random thing.
Let's switch talking about personal productivity. At the beginning, sure. You mentioned text expansion. I love it. I agree. Not many people use that. And I think not enough people use that. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Any other ones that you really like?
I was literally just writing a lot about this. I mean, I did talk a lot already about my to-do system. So task management, like I feel like that is having a system around that is super important. You're probably looking for tools or whatever, but I think the systems, like how you use those tools are just as important. So I use a system where I have each task gets a priority and a category. So it's like, how important is it? Like, is there consequences if I don't do it? Minor consequences if I don't do it? Is it just a nice to have? Or is it something I should be delegating? So that's like the priority. And the category is like, so I have daily categories, I guess. So on Monday, I work on content creation, Tuesday's content promotion, Wednesday's relationships. So I have like these categories, so, and it's a color based thing. So they all get a color and a column in Trello. Column is the priority. So then it's really easy on one, whatever day it is, to pick out what tasks I need to work on. I just look for that color, the day's color, and the highest priority ones get done first. So yeah, that's like a system that works for me. Obviously it might not work for everybody. I mean, another one, again, not a tool, but protecting your inbox. So a lot of people just operate out of email all the time. Like imagine giving your project management system link to like strangers and saying, here, just add tasks for me to do, right? Like that's insane. No one's going to do that. Yeah, that's what email is. It's a to-do list that other people add to. So you have to be really protective with that. Otherwise, you end up wasting way, way too much time. You know, that might mean using filters in Gmail to make sure like newsletters get put in a newsletter thing that you only check once a week. You know, and a really good tool for that is using plus in your email address. So if you write like your email address is like bob@example.com, you go bob+newsletters@example.com. This works with G Suite. I don't know about other tools, but it ignores the plus onwards. So it still comes to bob@example.com, but now you can create a filter on if it was addressed to anything with plus newsletters in it, it goes in the newsletters folder. So you can use that kind of trick to filter things to the correct email, sorry, the correct folder. And I mean, I think that's one of the biggest things. You get so much time back from doing your email, right?
I don't want to even mention anything. I want you to go on. So continue talking about all of those crazy, awesome, important things that many of us do not do. I don't use this plus sign. I know my husband does, but I mean, I've heard so many good things. I guess I need to start doing that. Tell us, give us a few more.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I use a tool called Follow Up Then. I'm probably going to switch to SaneBox because I already use SaneBox and I didn't realize it had a follow-up system built into it. not follow-ups. It's more about reminders of emails that you need a response to. So, for example, if I'm reaching out to someone to go on a podcast and I expect a response, people forget stuff. Like, I know not everyone is a zero inbox person, so they might forget that email, right? So it might get buried. So every email I send where the response is important for my business, you can use the CC field to go like 7 days at followupthen.com. And if they don't reply, then it bounces that email back into my inbox in 7 days. There's a lot of different tools for this. Like,
I love it.
Yeah. So, and like, it just keeps me on top of everything because otherwise I'll forget, right? Like, I'll send an email to someone, they'll forget, they'll lose the email and I'll forget, and that deal or whatever never happens. So the ability to follow up on email is just so freaking important. So Follow Up Then or SaneBox are two tools you can do. Use that. SaneBox is a whole different thing. Like, it actually helps you filter. It's actually a filtering system as well to help you filter like newsletters to the right folders and stuff. But I don't, like, it's a whole platform. We don't need to get into that, but it just has that follow-up system built in. Jeez, what else? Text expansion. If someone's listening to it, they don't know what that is. That's like when you create little snippets of text that automatically expand when you type them. So for example, I have snippets for anything that I'm typing like all the time. So our website, for example, or even our like business name, like I could type content snare, but instead I just type dot, like a dot, which is my like trigger to say that some text that I want expanded is coming. I go .cs and keep typing and that expands to content snare. I go .csw for content snare website, https://contentsnare.com, you know, content snare B for blog. You know, these are just simple links ideas, but you can have entire emails in there, right? Like, if I'm going to compose an email to one of those like companies that signed up that match my criteria, I have an entire email that I do, like, I think it's an onboarding email or something. So I go .obe and it pops up a box with placeholders in it. So I can type in their name and what their business name is. And then once I enter that, it drops that entire email into Gmail, for example. So text expansion is super powerful. Text Expander, I actually discovered yesterday, is capable of running JavaScript. So people that are listening to this, like, you could literally, and the way I discovered this is that there's a JSON pretty print built, like, that you can use in Text Expander just by like running JavaScript over what's in your clipboard. And then you can use a text expansion like .json to pretty print it into a notepad. Like, oh, that was super cool. Like, that example, I'm not going to tell anyone except technical people. So you get super complicated with that. And on typing productivity, voice typing is awesome. Like, I feel like that's something that everyone should be using, especially if you're on your phone a bunch. Like, Android and iPhone both have a little microphone button. You can just hit record and talk into it. And as long as you speak clearly, it's pretty accurate, you know, and it's better than typing on a friggin' phone keyboard, which is awful. But it turns out Mac and Windows both have this built in already. It's hit the function key twice on Mac and Windows key L, I think it is. L? Nope, not L. Shit. I should know this. Yeah, Windows key H. And it's built in. Like, you can literally just press that and start talking to your computer and it'll type for you. Super cool.
James, so many cool ideas here. I don't want this to stop. Give us a couple more maybe.
Oh man. Video speed controller. I mean, if you're watching videos as a browser extension, I mean, some video platforms have speed controls built in now, but I like the Chrome extension video speed controller because it adds keyboard shortcuts. You just press D a bunch of times and it speeds up the video like 0.1, oh, so 10% at a time. And so you can, like, at some point. Sorry?
Any video?
Yeah, do it on Facebook, Vimeo, YouTube, whatever.
My goodness, that's such a great trick, because I hate watching videos on Facebook because they don't have the speed up button. I do it all the time on YouTube or like other places, but not on Facebook. Now I have my solution.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I wish you could do it on Netflix sometimes. And here's another random one. Custom assistant, voice Google Assistant commands. You can create using if this then that, ifttt.com. It's kind of a Zapier competitor, but like I'd say not as powerful, but it has like, it's more for home automation and I guess personal type stuff. But with it, you can create custom Google Assistant commands. Like, so I can call out Google, I'm not going to do it because my phone will wake up, and then say like add prepare for the podcast to my Trello. And it goes, okay, adding prepare for the podcast to your Trello. And it shows up in my Trello. So you can you can create custom commands, which is awesome. Zapier are kind of working on this, but it's just not the same. You kind of have to ask it to speak to Zapier, and then Zapier comes back and says, what would you like to do? And then you have to say the Zap name. And then, yeah, it's a bit annoying. But the IFTTT one is really powerful. I think that's pretty much all the main ones I want to get through. Like, there's lots of small stuff, but I feel like, you know, at some point it just becomes too much.
Are there any questions that I haven't asked you, but I should have?
Again, like, there are a lot of people that resist automation because it's impersonal. I feel like SaaS founders are probably less likely to do that.
I agree. I think founders, especially tech founders, are going to be all over this. And my concern is that they're going to be like, okay, let me search all of those tools. And instead of, you know, working on all on the actual stuff that is important for them to complete right now, they're going to be so all over those tools, IFTTT, whatever. Yeah. And really, like, my concern is take it one step at a time.
Yeah, and that's actually, you raise a really good point there. It's probably something I should have brought up with that final question. It's in fact, it's like on my productivity talk that I give, it's like, it's literally slide 5. I've got the guy from Star Trek saying it's a trap, because like productivity can be a trap. You know, like, it's easy to fall into like, oh, okay, I'm just going to do everything now because I'm so productive. And you still, then you end up working the same amount of time or more time. And to me, that can, for me anyway, it leads to burnout, because I'm task switching so much because I'm getting so much stuff done. I burn out faster. And I think the trap really is using it instead of using like you doing all the tasks instead of hiring. Like, it's not a replacement for putting in good processes and hiring the right people. You still need to do that in your business. And when you're productive, like super productive, it's actually becomes harder to do that, because it's like, it's going to take me so long to train someone else to do it when I can just get it done in 20 minutes, you know, and they might take 2 hours to do that same thing when you first bring them on. But if you're going to succeed in business, you need other people to help you with this stuff. Like, you've only got so much time. Even if you're super productive, you're not going to get everything done by yourself.
Where can listeners know more about what you do and connect with you and maybe check out your course?
Sure. Well, jimmyrose.me is the main one. Like, I've got a guide there on that goes through some of my, like, some of the stuff we've talked about in more detail. It's free. Actually, I've got to put it on the homepage, which will be done right after we talk, but I literally just finished it. But it goes into like how I use email filters and labels, and like how I use text expansion, and how I use like my productivity system. So like Trello, for example. So that'll be there, jimmyrose.me. There's a link to the YouTube channel where I just release random like cool ideas that I have on productivity automation, and the course is there as well. It's all through that. If you want to check out our software for collecting information from people, it's contentsnare.com.
Jimmy, thank you so much for all of those nuggets of wisdom. That was really important, at least for me. I'm sure lots of people are going to find it useful as well.
No worries, Natalie. I love talking about this stuff. As you can probably tell, I'll go all day if I don't force myself to shut up, or you tell me to shut up. But yeah, thank you so much for having me.
And that's it for this episode. For those tech founders who have a remote team, I have a question. Do you find yourself that it's much faster for you to do things by yourself than waste all of that mental energy delegating tasks to someone? And so you either don't hire anyone, or if you already have a remote team, you're guilty of doing those tasks by yourself. because there's just so much energy goes into delegating the tasks and then just managing people. Are you able to take a few days off and not be worried that your servers will go down or your support is going to blow up? What if you could work on more strategic, important things and let your team fix the bugs? If you only started building your team in the last couple of years, I guarantee that you are making lots of mistakes that hinder your growth without even realizing that. Oftentimes, you, the founder, may end up being the bottleneck to your team's success. That is definitely hard to swallow, but it's true. But also look on the bright side, this is also the easiest problem for you to fix because you are in control of how to fix it. I'll be launching soon a program that will help tech founders improve your team performance and as a result, remove the roadblocks to scaling your SaaS just by improving your operations and team dynamic. This is really the shortcut. To be notified when it's live, go to my website, natalieluneva.com/team. natalieluneva.com/team.